So we had seen that the usual definition p equal to mass times velocity does not work well with Lorentz transformation. We took a simple example of elastic collision between two particles of equal mass, and then we solved all these equations and we found that in S frame the linear momentum is same before the collision, after the collision. But if I go to some other frame, S prime frame, then we saw that the linear momentum before the collision was 0 in y direction, and after the collision it is not 0 in y direction. So the law of conservation of linear momentum is valid in S frame, not valid in S prime frame, which is against the principle of relativity, that laws of physics have same form in all inertial frames. So if we still want to go with linear momentum conservation, then the definition of linear momentum has to be modified, and that is what is the topic I would like to address today. So how do I modify this linear momentum is equal to mass into velocity? So the linear momentum as we define in classical mechanics, Newtonian mechanics, is p is mass times velocity, and we modify it by multiplying a factor which will depend on the speed, because it is a speed which is crucial. Low speed works, high speed does not work. So it depends on the speed in some other fashion. So let us say that it is to be multiplied by some function of speed fv, and the requirement is that this fv should become 1 as you approach 0 velocity, because at low velocities it should work. So if I take this as the definition, let me write m naught. I have taken m naught here. If this is the definition where this fv, this function, this functional form I do not know as yet, we will derive, this goes to 1 as v goes to 0. This is our requirement. So we have to find what this function can be. So we come to the same example once again. Two particles of equal rest mass, equal mass m naught and m naught, going in opposite direction with same speed u, collide, and then they go this way. The same example we take. Now if I look at the new definition of linear momentum in the S frame, let us look at the S frame. What happens? This momentum and this momentum both are multiplied by the same factor fv. The speed is u here, the speed is u here, and therefore the total linear momentum is still 0. If I come here, once again the speed here is u, the speed here is u. So the factor which is multiplied fu, it's same here and same here. So they are equal and opposite. So this is also okay. So in S frame, conservation law holds. Now come to S prime frame. This is the story of S prime frame. Initially, before the collision, this particle was at rest in S prime frame, and this particle was going in this direction. So what is the linear momentum, initial linear momentum? Py is still 0, because in y direction there is no motion. Px you have to multiply by factor that we have taken. So here it is 0 velocity. So the linear momentum is anyway 0. Here the linear momentum is m naught into this velocity, that gives me the direction, and this should be multiplied by f of what? This should be multiplied by, this should be multiplied by f of velocity, and velocity is this. So 2u divided by 1 plus u square by c square. Okay, whatever is the functional form, that same functional form, but in place of this v, you have to write this 2u by 1 plus u square by c square, that is the speed here. And what happens this side? What happens this side? So, let me erase all this. This side, x direction, the linear momentum of this particle is in x direction from s prime after the collision, it will be m naught. I am writing px. So, m naught, let me put minus also, px is equal to minus m naught times x component is this, okay. Here it is. So, if you write x component px, that will be m naught into vx component, and function of v, this is a speed, remember this is a speed, so it remains the same. Py is m naught vy, then f of v, it is like this. So, here it is m naught and the velocity is 2u by 1 plus u square by c square. This is the x component of velocity, and this multiplied by what? Speed of the particle here, and speed of particle will be this whole square plus this whole square, and then the square root of that, that will be the speed. And you know what that speed will be finally? That will be 2u by 1 plus u square by c square. Why? Because this y component is delta u into something, right? So, this is the small quantity, infinitesimal of first order, and here it is a finite quantity 2u by 1 plus u square by c square. So, when you write this whole square plus this whole square, from the very beginning we have been neglecting this delta u terms if there is a finite term present in front of it as an addition. So, it is this. This is px, and no linear momentum in x direction from here, because this is going in y direction only. This linear momentum here is this, after the collision it is this, and before the collision it is if you take x component, this minus I cap, will just put a minus here. So, before the collision it is minus m naught 2u by 1 plus u square by c square, function of 2u by 1 plus u square by c square, you see this thing and this thing is same. If you write px, you put minus here and remove this I cap. So, this remains same. X component of linear momentum is not disturbed, it is conserved. Now comes the crucial thing, y component. Now, for y component, you know the y components, and therefore, you can write the momentum in y direction before the collision, and that is what Py is equal to 0, because this is at rest and this is going in x direction, negative x direction. So, Py is 0 before the collision. What happens after the collision? Py. So, look at this particle here, this B particle here, this is the velocity, this is the velocity. So, Py of the first particle, this particle is actually B. So, Py of B is equal to, direction is of course negative, y is taken that way, you can also take y this way, no problem. So, y B will be mass of the particle m naught, then component of velocity in this direction, that will be delta u, and square root of 1 minus u square by c square divided by 1 plus u square by c square, and f of speed of the particle. What is the speed of the particle? Speed of the particle is this much, right? This is that first order small quantity. So, speed of the particle, this is speed, it's same as this is speed in our approximation, and therefore, it is 2u by 1 plus u square by c square. So this is the linear momentum of this particle B in y direction. And what is the linear momentum of particle A in y direction? That also you can write. That also you can write. This is in positive y direction. So mass m naught into y component of the velocity, which is this delta u by square root 1 minus u square by c square, and then function of the speed. And what is the speed now? This is the speed, and we should write that delta u by square root 1 minus u square by c square. So consistently I am using this definition chosen, p is m naught v and then function of the speed. So x component, this v becomes vx, y component, this v becomes vy, this remains f of speed. So here the speed is this much, so it is a function of this. This I cannot neglect, because it is not in front of some finite quantity itself, but this function fv goes to 1 as v approaches 0, so that I get back my Newtonian definition p equal to mass times velocity for low velocities. And here this velocity is anyway infinitesimal, delta u divided by square root 1 minus u square by c square, and therefore this is the speed which is going towards 0, and f of this is 1. So you can write this as just m naught delta u divided by square root 1 minus u square by c square. So the total linear momentum in y direction will be this and plus this, and that should be equal to 0, because before the collision the linear momentum is 0. And we have put this function f of v etc. so that with new definition of linear momentum, the momentum should be conserved, should be same before the collision and after the collision. So to find the functional form, I can always say that this py is 0, so this py should be 0, so this plus this should be 0. So m naught delta u square root 1 minus u square by c square divided by 1 plus u square by c square should be equal to make total py 0, this should be equal to, no, this f is also there. So f of 2u by 1 plus u square by c square, this should be equal to what? This should be equal to this m naught delta u and divided by square root 1 minus u square by c square. This magnitude and this magnitude, they should be equal, so that when you add y component of linear momentum of A and B, it should be 0. So this is it. And you can cancel out this m naught du here, m naught du here, and you can write what is this f 2u by 1 plus u square by c square is equal to, this is 1 by square root 1 minus u square by c square, and then from this side you will have 1 plus u square by c square in numerator and square root of 1 minus u square by c square in denominator. So this function of 2u by this is equal to the right hand side, and from here this thing goes on the other side, this denominator goes in numerator and this numerator goes in denominator. So this is just
say c square plus u square, and here c square minus u square.
Okay, this is square root and this is square root. They become just 1 minus u square by c square, multiply by c square in numerator and denominator. This is c square plus u square, and this is c square minus u square. Now, we have some concrete result with us about this functional form f, and if I call this whole thing u, w, let us call it w, let us call w equal to 2u by 1 plus u square by c square, so that this becomes fw, and if I can write this in as a function of w, I know what is the functional form, and it's a very simple one, and I just do the shortcut. From this equation you can write u as a function of w, and then you can put that here, and this is fw is in terms of w. Now let us see what is w square by c square. W square by c square is 4 u square by c square divided by 1 plus u square by c square whole square, right? W by c, so divide by c, w by c is this, this is w by c square, so 4 u square by c square and whole square of this. So that is, you can write this as 4 u square, and remember this will be c square plus u square divided by c square, so c to the power 4 will come here, and this you can cancel, this is c square, and then it is c square plus u square whole square. Okay, simple algebra. When you square it, here you will get c square plus u square divided by c square, and squaring gives you c to the power 4 which goes up, and that c square cancels with that c 4 giving you this c square, and here it is c square plus u square whole square. What is 1 minus w square by c square? It is 1 minus this, so 1 minus 4 u square c square divided by c square plus u square whole square, and this is, this minus this is c square minus u square and divided by c square plus u square whole square. So what is square root of 1 minus w square by c square? It is c square minus u square divided by c square plus u square. And so what is this quantity? C square plus u square divided by c square minus u square. Look at here. It is just reciprocal. C square minus u square divided by c square plus u square. So this quantity is reciprocal of this. What you have is c square plus u square, or let me write it here itself, this is 1 by square root of 1 minus w square by c square, and this is w, so this is f of w, so this is f of w. So we have gotten the functional form, f of w is 1 divided by square root 1 minus w square by c square. So f of w is 1 by square root 1 minus w square by c square. So f of v is 1 by square root 1 minus v square by c square. This is the functional form. Whatever you put here, you write here. So our definition of linear momentum becomes p is equal to mass of the particle, then velocity, and then multiplied by this quantity, so you can write this in denominator, 1 minus v square by c square. So that's our modified definition of linear momentum. So if speed is low, if speed of the particle is much smaller than c, then this denominator will tend towards 1 and you get back your original definition of linear momentum. And if speed is not negligible as compared to c, then you must take care of this. If I define linear momentum in this fashion, which is slight modification of Newton's definition, Newtonian definition of linear momentum, even at high speeds the linear momentum will be conserved. So we have gotten all this using this specific example, but it is valid everywhere. Whatever example you take, whatever situation you take, if you take this as the definition of linear momentum, the principle of conservation works very well. So let us talk more about this. Let me first make some space. Now people still love that old definition P equal to m into v, and you can use that also, provided you define this quantity m naught divided by square root 1 minus v square by c square as mass. So if you define, let m is equal to m naught divided by square root 1 minus v square by c square, if the particle is moving with speed v, define this quantity m, m naught divided by, this is the mass of the particle divided by this, then you can still write p is equal to mv. That is why I have taken m naught here, so that I can use the symbol m here. People call this m naught rest mass. This is known as rest mass of the particle. M naught is called rest mass of the particle, and this m, which is defined this way, that m is called just relativistic mass. So if you use this word relativistic mass and define that as the mass of the particle, which is quoted in the textbooks, the mass of the electron is 9.1 into 10 power minus 31 kg and all that. So use that mass of the particle here, construct this quantity which will depend on speed. So this quantity, you can write this as m, and you can give it a name, relativistic mass, and the normal mass of the particle, textbook mass of the particle, is called rest mass. And of course, if v goes to 0, then the rest mass and the relativistic mass are the same. The characteristic property of the particle is the rest mass, m naught. And the relativistic mass is a mathematical construct. We have constructed a quantity and called it m. Perhaps the sole inspiration is to keep this definition, form of the definition p equal to mv, as intact. But it does not go a long way. The kinetic energy, for example, in Newtonian mechanics, low velocity, your kinetic energy is half m naught v square. But if you are at a larger velocity, if the particle has a large velocity and you say that, okay, its mass has increased and therefore the kinetic energy will be half into that increased mass into v square, it won't work. For linear momentum, yes. For linear momentum, yes. If you are at a higher speed and use this quantity here, p equal to mv works. But kinetic energy doesn't. So it's not a really a mass increasing, it's not that. The mass is there, which people call rest mass, but because of speed, you define a new quantity, a new mathematical quantity, and say that, okay, this will be like this. You can also preserve this p equal to mv definition, keeping the mass at same. Don't define any extra, and define a new kind of velocity. This is a new kind of mass you are defining. We can also define a new kind of velocity here. We can say that, okay, p
P is equal to ordinary mass into velocity, ordinary velocity divided by square root of 1 minus v square by c square. And let us say that this is something different, and we give a name for it. Let me give a name, I will justify later. It is proper velocity. Let us call it proper velocity. This v is ordinary velocity. Just like we had two kinds of masses, rest mass and relativistic mass. The Newtonian mechanics knows this mass only. In relativity, we do have this rest mass, and on top of this, we define relativistic mass. Similarly, in Newtonian mechanics, we have velocity. Velocity as we know it, dr by dt, vector dr by dt, velocity. But then we define another kind of velocity, v divided by 1 minus v square by c square, and give it a different name. Here also we gave it a different name, proper velocity, and give a different symbol also. Here also you have two symbols. So here also you give a symbol, and let's call it eta. This is proper velocity. Proper velocity. And this eta is this eta is v divided by square root of 1 minus v square by c square. Then also you can write p is equal to mass times this proper velocity. So you can call it relativistic mass times ordinary velocity, or you call it rest mass times proper velocity. What is the significance of this? Is there a significance of this eta, this proper velocity? Why we are calling it proper velocity? How you define ux? You define ux as dx dt. So if the particle is here at x, y, z at time t, and at t plus dt it goes to some other place, x plus dx, y plus dy, z plus dz, and this is time is t plus dt, you define ux as dx by dt. But these two events, the time interval between these two events is not the proper time interval. They are occurring at two different places. What is the proper time interval? If you take that proper time interval, and then you construct this quantity dx over that proper time interval between these two events, and similarly dy d tau dz d tau, tau d tau is the proper time interval between these two events, these are actually the components of that eta. So we will talk more about this eta, and we will show that yes, this is a useful quantity in relativity.